Ah ja. Okay.
Will you make available the notes? You can just scan them.
Just scan. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I scanned a few of them already, but not all of them. But we can, yeah. Mm-hmm. Good.
With Jan Steinhoff from the Albert Einstein Institute of Potsdam near Berlin. So last week you saw how to model the two-body dynamics. Then this week he will bridge the gap from modeling the two-body dynamics into building the wave. So pay attention because this is very important.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, so I will talk about mostly about the so-called effective one-body waveform model and how one can use that to construct gravitational waveforms. I put some handwritten notes here on that address. Also, there are some references there if you want to do further reading into the papers, so to say. Now, for the first lecture, I will actually more review some things that you probably have heard last week already, and then build on that in the following lectures to construct a complete waveform model for gravitational waves. Now, the system that I will be talking about well, it's exclusively binary systems here. So we will talk about gravitational waves from compact binary coalescence. Okay, so what does it mean? Compact binaries, you heard about that, I guess. That could be something like binary black holes. Or binary neutron stars. These how they orbit around each other, right? Due to their orbital motion, they emit gravitational waves, right? And that in turn means that the system loses energy and the two objects move closer and closer together while they orbit. This is a so-called in-spiral. So part of that coalescence is the in-spiral, where the two bodies move closer and closer together due to the energy and angular momentum loss from gravitational waves. At some point, they are so close together that they will merge into one body, an object. So at some point, there will be a merger. And in the end, well, you just don't have an object in equilibrium, but say when you have two black holes and they merge, the end state will be a perturbed black hole, which will somehow ring down and then eventually settle into an equilibrium state, into a normal static black hole or stationary black hole. And this last process, where basically the black hole gets rid of its perturbations, is called the ring down. So what we really want is a complete waveform covering all of these regimes, right? Because the system will evolve over time, and in general, all these phases will be visible when you measure gravitational waves. And the associated waveforms are often then called IMR, or in-spiral merger ring down waveforms. It's for the case of binary black holes. For neutron stars, things can be a little more difficult in the end. I mean, sometimes you don't have just a simple ring down, but a very complicated post-merger phase. Okay. Now, there could also be other objects that are merging out there in the universe, but for all we know, these should be black holes or neutron stars. But people also suggest that in the past so-called exotic compact objects, like boson stars, for example, but so far there's no hint that these exist in the universe. But through gravitational waves, in principle, one could try to find these kind of more exotic compact objects. Okay, now this is a very special type of gravitational waves, right? It's a in-spiral merger ring down wave, which looks well something like this. Yeah. Okay, that's not very good, but anyway, maybe you get the message. Of course, there can also be other gravitational waves, like when you have a supernova, a star explodes. Also in that process, you can emit gravitational waves. These would probably look a lot more chaotic. And the mechanism there is that supernovae are usually not spherically symmetric, so that they can actually have a time-varying quadrupole and then emit gravitational waves to the quadrupole formula. If supernovae were completely spherically symmetric, they wouldn't emit anything. But they are expected not to be exactly spherically symmetric. Then there could also be so-called continuous gravitational waves, which are waves at a single frequency, not like this one, where the frequency basically grows up over time. So this here is supposed to be the time axis. And continuous gravitational waves, where you have a fixed frequency, they could come from rotating neutron stars, for example. If you have a very compact, small neutron star, then it usually rotates at a very, very precisely at a fixed frequency. And if there's a small mountain or something on the neutron star, then again, you have a time-varying quadrupole, right? And these systems would emit continuous gravitational waves. And also the Big Bang could emit gravitational waves. And maybe there are also some surprises in the future. But the main source for gravitational waves, at least for the detectors that are currently operating or will continue to operate soon, are these types of gravitational waves coming from compact binary coalescence. Now, Yeah, what I was plotting here was basically this H plus or cross, which you probably have seen last week. And what I want to remind you here of is that basically you have different methods to make predictions in the different regimes shown here. And you somehow have to combine them into a single waveform model. So, for example, Blanchet was talking about the post-Newtonian approximation, and that one might be valid for somehow the early in-spiral, so for something at very low frequencies, somewhere over here. That would be, this you could predict with the post-Newtonian approximation, right? Then when the two objects come very, very close together, the gravitational interaction becomes very strong and you cannot use approximation methods anymore. And there typically you want to use simulations. So at some point here, maybe you need to use numerical simulations, or numerical relativity simulations, and you would hope that there's some kind of overlap so that you could stitch the two waveforms together. And the very last part, for that one, you also have a different method. It can be eventually a little more precise than numerical simulations, or at least it's easier to do. Namely, when you have a final merged black hole, which is slightly perturbed, you can again use perturbation methods. So here you could start with a black hole and perturb it. So this could be treated by black hole perturbation theory. Okay. So that's overall the picture. So you need to apply different methods for different parts of the waveform and then somehow combine them to a single waveform model. Just a bit of nomenclature. So somehow for this part here, this is usually called the in-spiral. And here you have the typical behavior, namely that the frequency of a gravitational wave goes up over time and also its amplitude goes up. And that's simply due to the fact that, well, the system is in-spiraling, the two bodies come closer and closer together, which means that due to Kepler's third law, the frequency must go up, right? And that's unusually called a chirp because it sounds a bit like this, like whoop, which is similar to the noise that birds make, and this is why it's called a chirp. Okay, then at some point, which is not so easy to define sometimes, you transit from the in-spiral to the plunge, where somehow the rate at which the bodies move together becomes very quick, so to say. And then at some point here, you have the ring down. And that point over here, you might want to call, sorry, that one. That's where the merger happens, where the two black holes touch and form a single black hole. So that's the overall picture, right? Now, Yeah. This picture here mostly applies for binary black holes only. If you have a binary neutron star or a system of a neutron star and a black hole, the thing is a little more complicated. So for binary consisting of a neutron star and a black hole, things are a little bit different towards the end here. So this is, let me write this here. This is binary black hole, black hole. And yeah, here in that case, you have some kind of matter which somehow spirals into a bigger black hole, typically. Because the mass of a black hole is thought to be bigger than the mass of neutron stars. Right? And eventually there's also a kind of mass gap between them, which is not yet clear if it exists or not. Now, physically, what will be different here? Right, that's the question now. Here, the black holes simply touch, they form a bigger black hole, and that black hole will somehow settle down into a stationary state. When you have a binary consisting of a neutron star and a black hole, then it can happen that the neutron star gets disrupted due to the tidal forces, right? In a binary system, you always have the thing that one body acts with tidal forces on the other, just like in the Earth-Moon system, right? The Moon pulls on the oceans of the Earth, and that gives rise to tides. The same is happening in this kind of binary systems, only that basically the black hole is pulling on the neutron star, and it's creating a tidal bulge on the neutron star. So could maybe draw it like this. So say this is a black hole, and now we have a neutron star, then that neutron star would be somehow deformed like that. Right? So it's not a sphere anymore, but it's deformed due to the forces that pull in that direction and compress it in that direction. Now, that can lead to a tidal disruption. If the tidal forces are very strong, the neutron star simply ripped apart. And in that case, basically, you don't have any ring down. When the neutron star is disrupted, there's no gravitational wave, or basically, there's no gravitational wave coming out of the system anymore. The compact object just disappears, so to say, that one. Yeah? And then maybe there's some gas around the black hole, which eventually falls into the black hole or forms an accretion disk. But there's no compact object anymore, so the gravitational wave emission basically goes to zero very quickly without having this kind of damped ringing. So in that case, there's basically no ring down. But it can also happen that there's no tidal disruption. Right. So if you make that black hole very, very massive, then the tidal forces become very weak. Right. So if you pass the horizon of a black hole, then the bigger the black hole, the weaker are the tidal forces. The tidal forces are always proportional to the size of the big black hole versus a small object to some power. Right. So that's what matters. And star always has more or less the same size, but if you make the black hole very big, the tidal forces become negligible, and then you wouldn't have any tidal disruption, and the waveform would actually be again similar to the black hole case. So whether this case or this case applies depends a lot on the mass ratio in the end. Now, good. So now we have considered the first example where you have a neutron star in the system, but you could also, of course, have a binary consisting of two neutron stars. And what happens then is the following. So the two neutron stars at some point also touch, they merge and form a bigger neutron star, which is often called a hypermassive metastable neutron star, or at least that's a standard scenario for that. And that star is metastable for several reasons. First of all, it rotates very rapidly, but and also in a differential way, but that eventually gets stemmed away a little bit. Plus, the material here also gets heated up a lot and then is cooled down again. And while it cools down, basically the neutron star becomes unstable, right? When the material is hotter, you have more pressure to stabilize the neutron star. And when it cools down, eventually it could collapse further. So usually what happens here is that you form a big neutron star and then after a very short amount of time, it collapses to a black hole. But the main message is simply that you have a very complicated interface. So everything that happens after the merger will be very complicated and difficult to model. But fortunately, people found that there are some characteristic frequencies in the waveform. The most important one comes from the fact that, in fact, after the two neutron stars merge, there are still kind of two cores inside that big neutron star which orbit around each other. And that gives rise to one of a very strong characteristic frequency. So one cannot model the full waveform as cleanly as over there, but at least one has some idea of some characteristic frequency or spectral lines, if you want, that should be there and that can be linked to the physics that's going on. Okay, so it's basically an overview of what can happen in a compact binary coalescence. But now the question is, how can you get such a full waveform covering an in spiral and a plunge and then a kind of merger with ring down or something else? Broadly speaking, well, there are different methods to create such complete in spiral merger ring down or IMR waveforms. The main idea usually is always that you, in some way, you combine the things that you learn from the post-Newtonian, weak field, slow motion approximation, with something coming from numerical relativity. I think the two big classes that are around are the so-called phenomenological models. This UB model from the title over there.
I
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay, I will repeat the question. I will explain again what this case with the node tidal disruption was briefly. So the thing is that the tidal forces on the neutron star depend on the size of the black hole, so to say. If you have a very big black hole, then the tidal forces at the horizon become very weak, right? If you have a very small black hole and you get close to the horizon and you are like a black hole is this size and you are 2 meters long, then you have incredibly large tidal forces acting on you. But if you are just an ant or something, there will be very small tidal forces because they are not proportional. They are proportional to the size of the body up to a certain power, something like power 4 or 5 or so, usually. Yeah. If you make the black hole very massive, it becomes big compared to the neutron star, and you will not have a tidal disruption. Right. Are there more questions up to here, maybe? Yeah? Wait. The what? Yeah, good. So in the first case, let's complete the second case. If there's no tidal disruption, the waveform should look very similar to a black hole. Black hole one, simply because you have two very compact objects, they in spiral, the neutron star will fall into the black hole, and it's like you have two point masses falling into each other. So there's no big effect coming from the fact that there's a neutron star around. And in the end, when it falls into the black hole, the end state will be just a single black hole, which is slightly perturbed. So it should look very similar to a black hole system. In that case, when you have tidal disruption, what happens is that the matter here will be ripped apart very suddenly. I mean, this is not a process that happens very slowly. It's once it starts, it's very quick, the tidal disruption. And then the matter will somehow be pulled around the black hole. But then you don't have a very strong concentration of matter at the single point, which orbits around the black hole. So the gravitational wave emission basically will go away. Right? So when the matter is spread out all around the black hole, there's no strong time-varying quadrupole anymore of the system that could lead to gravitational waves. Whereas when it's concentrated in one spot and orbiting around, you have the emission. Yeah? Yeah, so basically that phase here is almost missing. So the waveform will, once the neutron star is disrupted, it will basically go to zero. Maybe there's some small wiggle, but it's not as pronounced as in the binary black hole case. Or at least that's what one would think happens. And well, it's a kind of good approximation usually. Yeah. Okay, do you have more questions? Yeah? In which part? Yeah, so when you do, for example, numerical simulations, you mean? Yeah, that's a lot more complicated also, as far as I know, from the binary black hole case, because you have to do the relativistic hydrodynamics. What's also very challenging then is to get the microphysics of a neutron star right. So, I'm not quite sure, but whether at least the first simulations were done with a very simple model for the neutron star matter, and now it's successively improving. And various groups have reached a different state, so to say. But there are still also many open questions of how accurate these simulations are, or if all the physics is already in there. But fortunately, there's still a little bit of time, because this is also all happening for binary neutron stars. This is happening at quite high frequency, and the gravitational wave detectors are not yet that sensitive there. But yeah, that's a difficult problem, to get the merger of a neutron star. Maybe. Or maybe it's solved already. It's hard to say. Yeah. More questions? No? Okay. You can also interrupt me at any point, of course. Okay, good. So I was saying that now we want to try to combine the post-Newtonian part, which happens here at low frequencies, with numerical simulations which cover and the end of the waveform. The two classes of models are called the phenomenological models and the EUB model. At least these are the two the two most prominent approaches to that. And in some sense, I think they do the same in that they combine post-Newtonian information with numerical relativity. They just do it in somewhat different ways. As far as I understood it, these phenomenological models, they are really supposed to be very fast and very comfortable to use in the data analysis process. One could say that here the emphasis is a little more on low computational cost. While in the EUB model, at least people try to argue from a physics point of view a little more how to construct the different phases. So here one might say that the emphasis is a bit more on the physics. But I mean, as time progressed, of course, people also tried to make the EUB model much faster and quicker. And on the other hand, it's also not the case that the phenomenological models don't contain physics, of course. So there's not such a clear cut between the two, I would say. But at least initially, this was maybe the situation. So yeah. There's not always a clear cut. In the end, you always want an accurate waveform, so you have to do some kind of fitting or calibration, however you want to call that, to make the waveform accurate in all regimes. And if you maybe have a nice insight into the physics, but it doesn't give you an accurate prediction, it also doesn't help you so much. We will also see later where the details in particular are. Okay. So one thing I also wanted to mention is that there are also the so-called reduced order models. This is more like a sophisticated way, in some sense, of compressing waveforms or also interpolating between them. One thing that you can do with them, for instance, is you can take a very slow computationally expensive EUB model, for example, and then you build this so-called reduced order model just to make it then very fast. So then in some sense, you have built an interpolation based on a few waveforms coming from that EUB model. And that's one way to make the EUB model a bit faster. Okay. I want to recap a little bit how to get a waveform for the in-spiral. Now that was probably explained by Luc Blanchet in the last week quite extensively. So I will not, review everything about that, but just a few important things. So to say, what is the basis of that approximation? So that you have an idea or that you recall when it is applicable and why it eventually breaks down at some point. That's enough for now. So, let's look at the in spiral. As predicted by the post-Newtonian approximation. So what you assume there is that you have a separation of scales. So say you have a black hole here and you have a black hole here and the two are orbiting each other. Then you can apply the post-Newtonian approximation when the scale of the orbit, so this size, is large compared to the size of a black hole, roughly speaking. Yeah, so here this could be called the body scale, and here too. That regime here would be the scale of the orbital motion, right? So that's the orbital scale. And then when the binary revolves, it will emit gravitational waves, which will propagate outwards at some point. So further out, you have the waves, or the scale of the gravitational waves. Okay, so that's a general picture that you have of a system described by the post-Newtonian approximation. You have the scale of the body, you have the scale of the orbit, and then further out, you have a scale where the gravitational waves are propagating. The main reason why you can apply approximations, or the main condition that must be fulfilled, is that all these scales are separated. Which also means they are decoupled from each other. So then, if that's the case, approximation methods are possible, essentially. This whole business is still not very, very easy for many reasons. First of all, the computations are difficult because all of this is happening in general relativity, which is a nonlinear theory. And also, these different scales decouple approximately, but not exactly. There's still some talking between them. In particular, from the bodies here, you can have effects from their multipole structure. So the black holes could, for example, spin or rotate. And that gives rise to spin effects, which are kind of like gravitomagnetic effects. So they are similar to magnetic effects in electrodynamics. Plus, the black holes of neutron stars can be kind of deformed. So they would have a quadrupole moment, an octupole moment, and so on. So they can have multipoles. They are not just point masses, so to say. To a good approximation, you can describe them by point masses, by all the mass sitting in a point, but that's not exactly true. And when you include all these multipoles, basically you are including effects from the structure of neutron stars or the black holes. Related to that, there can also be tidal effects, tidal forces. Like when one of these guys is a neutron, then the neutron star will get deformed. You also have to include that in the post-Newtonian approximation and in the treatment. So you can have tidal deformation. You can also have so-called tidal heating. So that's a dissipative effect. And here I would also include absorption from the black hole horizon. So, in some sense, what that means is that part of the gravitational waves could be falling into the other black hole and never reach infinity. This could be called a tidal heating effect. That also would need to be included. And you could also have resonances. Like when you deform a neutron star somehow and then you basically let it go again, what will happen is that it will start to oscillate. So neutron stars have characteristic oscillation mode frequencies, just like a guitar string or most physical systems have. And basically, when the orbital motion hits that characteristic frequency, then basically the neutron star can start to resonate and start to oscillate, right? Because the tidal forces create a bulge on the neutron star, and when that bulge is rotating exactly at the resonance frequency, then you have a kind of you can have a resonance catastrophe. So there will be a lot of energy going into the oscillation mode of the neutron star. So this could also happen. And another effect that's weak, but nevertheless very interesting, is the so-called tail effect. What I mean by that is that the gravitational waves, when they propagate outwards, they can get backscattered by the potential that is created by the binary. So not all the gravitational waves will reach infinity, but some of them will get scattered back and then can interact with the binary again. And this is so-called tail effect, which adds the dynamics at the fourth post-Newtonian order, for example. And well, it enters the waveform even sooner. Have you heard about that in last week's lectures? At some point? Maybe. Okay. Anyway, that's one of the complicated things that can happen. Okay. But now, in order to make our lives a little bit easier, let's from now on assume that we have an almost circular orbit. So the separation between the two bodies is approximately constant. And well, that's a nice approximation because things become very simple. Also, it's very well justified for the systems we are looking at because while the binary in spirals, and maybe it starts with an eccentric orbit, while it in spirals and loses energy and angular momentum, the orbit will become more and more circular due to the emission of gravitational waves. I have no very good explanation why that's happening, but in some sense, every dissipating system is trying to get into some kind of equilibrium state, and in some sense, a circular orbit is more in equilibrium than an elliptic orbit, right? Because it's emitting gravitational waves at different rates along the orbit, while a circular orbit is a more more stationary emitter in some sense. But yeah, that's a very hand-waving argument, of course. Exceptions, like when a system is formed dynamically at a very close distance, it can still be very eccentric close to the merger. But the standard scenario is that when the binary approaches the merger, the orbit is almost circular. Good. Now, in the circular orbit case, there's a quantity which nicely wraps up the post-Newtonian information in the conservative part of the dynamics, and that's the so-called binding energy. Then basically you combine this information of a binding energy with the gravitational wave flux, and just from these two ingredients you can get the evolution of the gravitational wave phase. So let's recall how this is going. So in the PN approximation, basically, we assume that the system is in a weak field regime, and that the two objects are moving rather slowly compared to the speed of light. And these two things are not independent of each other due to the third Kepler law, right? So when the system is moving at a shorter distance, so more in the strong field regime, it will also orbit faster due to the third Kepler law. So the weak field assumption and the slow motion assumption are linked together through the third Kepler law. So in the end, you just have a single parameter, which is often called x, which is small. And this could be seen as the total mass divided by the distance of the two. So that's a measure for the gravitational field strength. Or the velocity. And these two are linked through the third law of Kepler, which is omega to the square times r to the 3 equals the total mass in our units. Oh, well, let's make that something like this, because the equal sign strictly only holds in the Newtonian limit, right? Okay. And there's a different way of writing this parameter, which is m times omega to the power of 2 over 3. So by applying the third Kepler law, one can see that these three things are all the same, basically. And the post-Newtonian assumption now is that that parameter is much smaller than one, and then you can do a perturbation expansion in the parameter. So you may have noticed that I'm setting the gravitational constant and the speed of light equal to one, as is often done in that context. And yeah, let me give you some definitions of the masses that we will use. So we have the total mass, which is m1 plus m2. The famous reduced mass that you might recall from classical mechanics, which is M1 times M2 divided by the total mass. So that's the reduced mass. And what's also often useful is the symmetric mass ratio, which is the ratio of the reduced mass and the total mass. Well, that thing is not so common usually, but it's a very nice quantity because it's dimensionless. In some sense, it's a natural way to write down the post-Newtonian approximation, where only the mass ratio should matter in the end, at least when you don't have spins on the black holes. Now, you may easily check that reduced mass ratio can vary between 0 and 1 over 4 only, where this here basically would be the test mass case, and this here would correspond to equal masses. Okay. Having this kind of notation, we can now nicely express the post-Newtonian results for circular orbits in a very compact form. So let's look at the so-called binding energy, which is basically the energy of the whole system minus the rest mass energies divided by the symmetric, by the reduced mass. So this is a dimensionless quantity. And if you do the post-Newtonian calculation, what you get then for the binding energy, so this is called small e, what you get is the following. It's minus 1/2 times x times 1. And then there come a lot of corrections coming from the post-Newtonian expansion. So I'm just writing down the first term, which would be 1 over 12 times 9 plus symmetric mass ratio times x, and then it goes on for a while. Now these dots here, the corrections here are known actually to the power x to the 4, which is a false post-Newtonian order, right? So the expansion parameter is called x, and post-Newtonian expansion of the binding energy means basically you write this as a polynomial in x. And it's known up to the power x to the 4. You can do the same for the gravitation wave luminosity. So basically the energy radiated in form of gravitational waves. And well, it goes in a similar way. You have some leading order term, which is 32 over 5 times symmetric mass ratio square times x to the 5. And then you have something like 1 minus, and now there come some crazy numbers. 1,247 divided by 336, plus 35 divided by 12 times symmetric mass ratio, and all that times x, and then it goes on. So the expansion doesn't always look particularly nice, as you can see here, but in the end it's just an expansion in X, and you get some result for that. And this thing here is known to the order X to the 7/2. So that would be 3.5 PN. So yeah, you also see here that there are half orders coming in at some point. That essentially comes in when you have radiation reaction forces which are dissipative and have a little bit different character, so to say. Okay, so that looks kind of okay, I hope. You can work that out, and it's not easy, it's hard work, but once you have these, what can you do with that, right? So you have the energy, and you have basically the energy that's radiated. So what you want to do then, when you ask yourself how is the system evolving in time, is you make an energy balance, right? You say the rate of change of that energy equals to the luminosity, to the amount of energy that's radiated in terms of gravitational waves. So let's make an energy balance between the two. And the logic here is going. So if you switch off radiation, then the binding energy would be conserved. But since you have that radiation, the energy will slowly become smaller. And here the important thing is that this should happen slowly. Yeah, so you make a kind of adiabatic approximation where the system essentially orbits on the same orbit at the same distance, approximately, and then there's a very weak effect coming from the energy loss which slowly makes the orbit shrink over many, many, many orbits. So it's an adiabatic approximation that we make here, right? Because we have here the orbital frequency, and then we have this time scale of the radiation reaction, of the effect of the shrinking of the orbit, so that we can talk basically of a time evolving frequency. This only makes sense in an adiabatic approximation, right? Yeah. So you have basically the time scale of the orbital motion, which is very fast, and then you have the time scale of the radiation reaction, which is very slow. And yeah, then you write down that the change of the binding energy over time, and this is a time derivative with respect to the slow time, to the radiation reaction time, not to the orbital time scale. And that should equal minus the gravitational wave luminosity. That's the energy balance. A second equation that you could write down is this one here. So the frequency of the orbit is associated to the phase in the orbit by this equation. This is, I hope, kind of obvious. So phi here is just the phase. Okay, one can rewrite this in a slightly different way, these two equations, with the help of that, the definition of that X over there. So we could write dx over dt is equal to minus L divided by dE over dt times 1 over mu. Yeah, so that's basically just putting that thing on the left hand side. Yeah. Okay. Now, and the second equation starts d phi over dt equal to x to the 3/2 divided by the total mass. Now, these two equations you can now solve in different ways. You can solve them numerically or analytically also, since we are working here in an approximate. So here, from here, you have analytic and numeric solutions. And depending on the details, how you exactly do that, whether you try to solve them fully analytic in an approximation x again, or if you just try numeric different ways, you get the so-called Taylor T something models. So that's basically a gravitational waveform models only for the in-spiral in some way based on these two equations. And well, they only describe the in-spiral, and they describe them using the post-Newtonian information from over there, using this energy balance. Yeah, there are other models. Well, I mean, in the end, of course, these in-spiral-only models are not so interesting in the end, most of the time. But let me just mention another one, which would be the Taylor F2 waveform model, where basically, yeah, you solve the thing in frequency domain. So analytic solution for phi of t and plug that into the gravitational waveform, and then you also do analytically a Fourier transform to get a waveform in frequency domain. And yeah, that Fourier transform was done in this called stationary phase approximation. But yeah, that's not that that important here. I just want to mention that. But overall, of course, there are some shortcomings of this approach, even just for the in-spiral part, which can reach into the strong field regime. So one problem with this approach is that the motion doesn't always stay exactly spherical, right? We have assumed that the system is moving on a spherical orbit, but that's just an approximation. The approximation becomes more and more unjustified when the system moves closer together. So one problem is that the motion is not exactly spherical. In particular, during the plunge. Right? So, yeah, if we want to go a little bit beyond just the into the plunge where the two objects approach each other very rapidly, there is a strong radial motion in the radial direction. So it definitely is not, cannot be very well approximated by a spherical motion anymore. So that's one problem that needs to be addressed. Another problem is that overall this post-Newtonian approximation is just a so-called asymptotic series. Asymptotic which basically means that in the end you always want to resum it in some way. So you don't want to keep it in this Taylor expanded form, but you want to have a more nicer compact expression by some resummation. And one thing that one could try here is the following. One case which can be treated very well is a different approximation, which is a test mass approximation, right? Where you have a black hole and then a very small body, which basically doesn't perturb the space-time, but is orbiting that black hole. So that thing you can also treat very well, very analytical. Right, because you know the solution for the metric, you know the solution to the field equations, and then you just solve the geodesic equation in that space-time. So one thing that one could try to use as an inspiration of what how to do a resummation is to look at the test body case. And let me just write down the formula that holds then, just to show you that it looks kind of different from the thing over there. So for test bodies, E of x would be 1 minus 2x divided by square root of 1 minus 3x minus 1. So that thing would hold in a test body case here. First of all, you see it's not a polynomial in x, it's more like a rational function, and there are even square roots appearing. So resummation basically means that you look at that formula here, which is a Taylor expansion in some way, and you want to combine it in some way with that thing over there. So in some sense, interpolate between the two, like putting some new corrections, some corrections in the symmetric mass ratio somehow into that formula. Of course, it's still very arbitrary in the way that you could do that, but somehow that's the idea of that effective one-body formalism, where you try to basically map the motion of a binary system at arbitrary mass ratio nu, to a motion of some test body in an effective space-time. And yeah, we will then see basically how one can make that more precise, and also we will see that it's not as arbitrary as it may seem right now. So are there questions up to here now? So that was supposed to be more a quick review of how to do the post-Newtonian approximation and how to build in spiral waveform models out of that by using, say, the energy balance, balancing the binding energy to the gravitational wave flux, and then basically getting the time evolution of x, which is the frequency, or time evolution of the phase. And let me just remind you at the end how the gravitational wave would look like. I mean, I was drawing it in the beginning in a pictorial way. But of course, there's also a formula for that. So we have the amplitude of the gravitational wave, which is xh plus is equal to minus 4 mu divided by r, which is the distance between the source and the observer. And here we have some directional dependence, 1 plus cosine theta divided by 2. And for the other polarization, we have something very similar. So it also starts like form U divided by R and cosine theta. So that's basically the distance and the angle at which the observer is looking at the system. So when you have a black hole here, and here somewhere there's an observer, then this would be R, and theta is, I think, this thing, I think, that angle here. And yeah, now that's all the directional dependence and distance dependence of the gravitation wave polarizations that are measured by a detector. And now finally we have the phase dependence, which is given by cosine 2 phi times x and sine 2 phi times x. And then again, there are a lot of post-Newtonian corrections over here. And yeah, into that thing, basically, here you plug in phi of t and x of t, and then you have the waveform. And phi of t and x of t you get from these two equations over here. Yeah, so that's actually how you can compute a post and waveform. And yeah, I mean, I've omitted all these ugly looking corrections over there, but conceptually, there's no difference in the end. That's really the concept behind that. Yeah, maybe make one last remark. So what you also see here is that the frequency of the gravitational wave is 2 times the orbital frequency, right? So here you have the phase of the gravitational wave is 2 times the phase of the binary motion. Yeah, you directly see that here in that equation. Do you have some question on that part? Yeah. I will then actually continue with the effective one-body model, and the picture, as I said, is you start looking at a test body in the metric of a black hole, and which would be described by that formula, and somehow want to combine that with the post-Newtonian results in some nice way. I will just write down the thing that I will start with in the next lecture. Namely, yeah. So that thing here is described, the small guy is described by the diegetic equation. And in the form of an action, this is described by a so-called point mass action given by minus the mass of a small guy times d tau, where d tau is the proper time of the small guy moving along that geodesic here somehow. You can write it in the following way, like an integral over a generic affine parameter, which doesn't have to be the proper time, times the mass again, and times minus g mu nu u mu u nu, where u mu, well, it's not the normal four velocity that's defined with respect to the proper time, but this four velocity here I define with respect to a generic affine parameter. So in particular, that means that the four velocity is not normalized to minus one here. But the four velocity has four independent components, one corresponding basically to the fact that you have a, well, that this is a generic parameter and not the proper time or any special time. Okay, so I will continue with that in the next lecture and show you some transformations of that, that is very useful to treat that. Yeah, thanks.
Questions?
Yeah.
My question is about when you have two black holes rotating in each other, and what is happening with the event horizon surface? What is happening when?
When
you are not in the spiral regime.
You mean in the spiral regime?
No,
what happens after? Yeah. So
I think that probably you have a deformation of
the Yes, exactly. Yeah. So the black holes will start at some separation and then spiral. Then somehow they will touch somehow, right? And at that point, that's already a single black hole. When they touch, you have a single event horizon, but it's completely deformed, obviously. And then it will ring down, so to say, and slowly approach that state here. Maybe at this point, it's a little bit deformed, and the deformation is wobbling around, and then eventually it's just a single black hole.
And also, in the normalization of the velocity, why is not minus one? Or it's because I'm in accelerating? Or
yeah, so if this would be the proper time, then it would be minus one. But here, in some sense, we make a transformation from tau to some generic parameter. And there's no special relation that this one fulfills, right? So the proper time is very special in that it's basically the time that you measure when you move along that geodesic, and it's the time that your watch will show the proper time. And this parameter, it's just a very generic parameter.
It's not in the case of the photons that you assume that you have a linear.
Yeah, so you also do that for photons. There you have to do that because the proper time is not well defined. Right? So there you have to do it. Here you don't have to, but still it's convenient often to do that. Because when you do... so that thing you can gauge fix later on. So you could, for instance, say, okay, sigma now should be like the coordinate time, and this can sometimes simplify computations. So the idea is more you go from the proper time to some generic time, do some calculations, and then you fix it to some convenient choice that simplifies your calculation. Yeah.
Okay, so we have coffee, we reconvene at 11:45.
Yeah? Sorry.